Okay, well, I guess we could just get going anyway, right? I'm looking at our Master of Ceremonies over here. Really, I mean, you know, if we're all just ready to go home, we can just go home. If anybody has any questions or wants to press any of the things that we've been talking about further, or you have some wisdom to add, to give, you know, then now's the time to do it. It's open season.
I have a practical question, I guess.
Yeah.
Right in the middle of your book where there's a staple you can see, you have your fellowship with Jesus and your society and classes and bands and that sort of thing.
Yeah.
I can definitely relate with a lot of what you're saying and I'm agreeing in a lot of directions. One of the things for us, we're across the street at Free Methodist Church there, which...
Hmm.
Somebody who's from England, this is not very old, but we're 137 years old.
Ooh, well done.
Yeah. Like, yeah. No. 800 years, whatever. But we're an old church for around Kansas.
Yeah.
And one of the things that's, I think, difficult for us is we're kind of to a point where we've redone some things in a section of discipleship. I would say it's in kind of that classes 12,
yeah,
small groups area, in a church that has kind of had Sunday school classes that kind of reach into a lot of those three areas all at once, without a clear definition or focus.
Yeah.
As we look at, I think it's we find it important to do something more in that band's area.
Mm.
But how does that work? We're a church of maybe 320, 350, I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
We have the crowd. We have even a good attendance even in that classes. How does that work in your experience? How do we get people who want to do this band thing that you've been spending a lot of your time on? We were just talking, can it be 100% organic? And if so, how can you sort of oversee that? How can you make sure that it kind of, we start backwards in our case,
Right.
Start with that little thing and send it out in a way. Does
that make sense? Yeah, completely. Oh, well, I think so. I'll try answering it, and then you can tell whether I'm answering the question you actually asked.
We're trying to do that first, sort of.
Yeah. Whenever answering questions like this, I always want to preface it kind of wisdom, not law, because, there's so many variables but some things that I would have learned over time. Let me sort of go via negativa and say what I don't think is a good idea. There are those that I've come across that would want to turn to have a band program, right? So to programatize this, and so the language is usually like, so how do we roll bands out? How do we roll it out? All that kind of language, right? And do we divide the congregation up and blah blah blah? And that's I know you wouldn't even go there, but it's worth just saying. This works, with people who are hungry, and who are ready, to take some next steps, I would say. And my preferred option always, or my starting point in making suggestions about how you start this, we do have material that you can turn to if you want. Explain some of this, but my preferred way would always be to say, start with you gathering a band, and exercise patience. Gather a band and then invest in them till this practice becomes sort of second nature to them, with the view that they then will go, and start a band for themselves. Now, my suggestion would be that in that phase, you still keep meeting with the main band. So those guys, are in more than one band at the same time. They are, you continue to work with them to explore best practice, and wisdom around that by doing it, and support them as they pioneer and plant new bands. Now, it might be that you have the capacity to simultaneously start more than one band and mentor that, and then, you know, it kind of multiplies quicker. In fact, even I would suggest that when you ever start these things, having the idea of multiplication as part of the ethos from the beginning, you know, this is what we're out to do, rather than try to smuggle it in later, you know. But I would say that even when you don't set out that way, there is often a tipping point that happens. So sometimes it happens like this, and it happened recently to me in a band that I was mentoring, where one guy said, you know, I was having this conversation with so-and-so, and I could tell that the sort of spiritual conversation that we've been having in band, that dynamic, they were beginning to have with this other person, you know. And he came back to this band and said, you know, I was having this conversation, and I said to that person, I said, you know what you need? What you need is to be in a band. You know, and they said, but I don't play a musical instrument. That's okay. Okay, you know. So, actually, it doesn't really matter what you call these things, you know. This is just language that's part of the tradition. And then, of course, we, hearing him say that, we said to him, so go and do it, right? You know. So, you know, you already that kind of that desire of being a disciple and then to make disciples, you know, who makes those, begins to get worked out naturally. And sometimes you can begin to introduce it. So, you know, who we're having conversations with, etc. I mean, it's part of the... So, and then that kind of grows organically. Another thing that often happens when bands begin to get planted and spread is that it's the principle of what I would call holy jealousy. So, you know, there's such a thing as unholy jealousy as well, but, you know, holy jealousy. So somebody comes up to you and says, I hear so-and-so is in a band. Why aren't I in a band? You know, and you're like, yeah, oh, so you want to be in a band? We can do that. You know, and it's a bit like kind of a spiritual dating service. You know, as pastor, you know, you can have in your mind, you can have conversations with someone about who are in their networks of friendships, who might be displaying that kind of hunger, or might be, you know, they might you know, be already have. So part of that, the conversation is how you discern who to, you know, to be in band with, but. But I think always, as far as that goes, it's always good to start with the people that God already seems to be bringing around you, you know. And that's not necessarily the people that have been around you a long time. It could be somebody you've only met for a couple of weeks, but just, you know, something clicks and you just know that the Spirit is in it. God bless you. And is, you know, and is wanting to, is bringing you together for a purpose, you know. But it could be people that you've been around for a long time. So I think that kind of organic way of doing it is my preferred option. And, you know, there are some things to learn about how you multiply bands, because like the groups of 12, for instance, typically multiply, trying to remember my biology now, by mitosis, is that right? Is it the mitosis? Yeah, mitosis. They, you know, they get bigger and bigger, and then they split, right? Cells. Well, that can't happen with bands because the nature of the you know, it's too tight. They're more like closed groups, but they still multiply. But it's always it only happens one of two ways. Someone in that band will go and mentor a new band, and then, you know, be part of two bands. Now, what they might then decide to do. When they feel that band's got legs and is, you know, is working well together, is just pull back, or they might simply go and join that band, you know, and help them to multiply as well. So we, you know, there's a sort of bridging plant where you're in two at the same time, or there's ascending, so you can just go and start one. But that's pretty much. It's really as simple as that.
So you're saying, I mean, there's really not it has to be a parallel process. I mean, you're doing kind of church, like what we've always been doing, and this has got to be a parallel process. You can't really flip one into the other.
Well, in some instances, so for example, during the Billy Graham rallies, right, I find this, people, they encouraged people to get into prayer triplets. I don't know whether you're familiar with that, but it was just a part of that kind of crusade thing, right? So sometimes when I get into churches, there are people that have been in these, and they get together as threes to pray together, and they've been doing it for years, you know, and then we'll have conversations along these lines, and they'll say, you know, that's what we need to do with this existing group. So you can sort of, it can be that some existing groups can be transformed, you know, to go deeper from what they already are. Or if you start with existing small groups, one of the things can be just to see those who might be wanting to take whatever that small group is doing, but press in deeper still. And so it could be that people are already in those groups, can be encouraged to go deeper and build a rhythm of band and, you know, house group or whatever it is, into their discipleship. Does that help? Okay. Any other questions? Yeah.
Would you recommend having bands be exclusively one gender?
Good question. That was the slide I didn't get to. So, a little bit of the dynamic about bands. Remember I said wisdom, not law. We have bands that we know of that are all kind of, you know, that we recommend three or four. The reason that we recommend three or four is that it's really hard to do the kind of depth of relationship that we're talking about with more than that. Either that or every time you meet, you need to have a whole day, to have the kind of conversations that are necessary. So three or four, and we recommend meeting. This is going to sound a bit like a recipe for cooking a turkey, but we, you know, 30 minutes per person per pound. You know, you need at least about 30 minutes per. So for a group of three, you know, we'd say you need about an hour and a half at least to do this, to be able to pray together and then to each to begin to share and to have some conversation and to pray. And believe me, I don't know if that sounds like a long time or not a long time to you, but it just, you know, the biggest problem that bands have is actually being disciplined about keeping, not going on too long. Because, you know, especially if you're meeting in the evening, I mean, we've been up all night sometimes. And so three or four, for about that length of time, we recommend, so I'm expanding your question a little here. We recommend meeting at least monthly. Personally, I would prefer to say at least every other week. But at least monthly. What's the easiest way to kill a group?
Postpone it.
Yeah, postpone it. Don't meet. That's the quickest way to kill a group, is to cease to meet. Which is why the writer of the Hebrews says, you know, don't stop meeting, you know. Because, you know, momentum dissipates and all of that, you know. And anything, if you're meeting only monthly and you miss 1 month, it's like then 2 months, you know. And it's just very difficult. Which is why, actually, we encourage people, I mean, if sometimes the desired commitment for band seems too much for people, so we sort of say, "Oh, well, give it a go. You know, meet monthly, meet for this period of time, and see how it goes." But we've found that very quickly, people then say, "Wow, this is great. You know, we had our fear and trembling, but you know, it's actually really been a blessing after the first meeting. Let's start meeting every other week, or every week. You know, and so it builds." And then to the question about gender, we recommend trying single gender bands for some obvious reasons and less obvious reasons. It does tend to maximise sharing, you know, but having said that, we have bands that are mixed gender, and they work really, really well. What being in band doesn't either eliminate the possibility of having deep conversations with other people or an other person in the band on a different occasion or whatever, But, you know, it would seem that there are some guy things and some girl things that guys and girls like to talk about with other guys and girls and not guys and girls. Guys and girls. You know what I mean. I know. Maybe all that's disappearing. I don't know. But but that does seem to be, there's health in that, I think. And actually, in the traditions of the church, that has been wisdom. In early Methodism, Wesley had divided the movement. He actually also divided them up into age groups, but... You know, I can see the value of that too, although mixed age groups are really excellent, you know, ways of helping to mentor one another, you know, from those different perspectives. So. Does that answer your question?
Yeah.
Kind of.
Yeah, all right.
Okay. Any other questions about any of the above? Yeah.
One of the, in that section on one anothering.
Yeah.
Where we start off at the top with worship and ministry, and then down at the bottom with spiritual friendship and conversation. You did a kind of informal poll with us,
yeah.
And we were all really good with worship and ministry, yeah. And you got towards the bottom, you were completely expecting the fact that we're not as good at that.
Yeah.
With this group of mostly college students that are involved in ministry, help me understand why do ministers stink at that?
Why do they? You're asking me why they do that? Yeah.
You read the studies all the time about ministers are lonely, they don't have friendships, all that kind of stuff.
Yeah,
so how can we help a younger generation learn how to be relational while they're in ministry?
Build this into the training program.
Yeah.
Everywhere, you know, everywhere I go, it's the kind of dirty secret, you know, ministers are depressed, burnt out, leaving the ministry, right, left and center. Attrition rates are horrific. Mm-hmm. You know, listen to this, guys. You know, you may not think it, but it's terrible. And for all of the reasons that I outlined, you know, at the beginning, you know, these things happen. And you know, and I've been there. You know, I've gone through seasons in my life where I've been curled up in a ball on my bed, shaking, not wanting to face the day. The first time that happened, I didn't have this. The second time I did, and it was a wonderfully healing experience. And actually, out of that, the ministry that we are now doing with this stuff widely was born out of the ashes. That God can redeem these things, and that, but I think that He does that through the. And we just got to. I think we need to encourage people. We just need. There's so many issues. We need to learn how to be more vulnerable with one another. We need to learn how to share our lives more deeply with one another. We need to. We need to learn how to be countercultural in these things. And frankly, sometimes the structures of the institutions of the church don't help, because you know, you start being vulnerable and all the rest of it, and you know. And the way that we measure success and all of the rest of it, all of these things can mitigate against the very stuff that we're talking about and drive people into these places. So I think it helps to kind of, I think, begin to change the culture, you know, by you know, having, I mean, it would be great, you know, if I don't know what's the frame method, districts or whatever, you know, began to encourage. So it wasn't just an, you know, so for instance, here's a for instance, because there's so much that could be said on that. I mean, I know amongst my Irish Methodist friends, right, they love to do this, but they feel horribly, now this might be a kind of Protestant Northern Irish guilt syndrome, but they feel horribly guilty about taking time to do this kind of thing when they ought to be doing something more productive. Mm-hmm. Well, you know, that's a culture issue. You know, I mean, how can you be who you need to be in ministry, and let's not say productive but fruitful, if you aren't doing that? You know, how do we change those cultures where actually we see that it's an investment and we need to be held accountable for it? You know, I mean. Wesley was not against lazy ministers, right? You know, but there's a difference between that and the kind of drivenness that comes from guilt or whatever. So actually, the authorities in the church, I think, can begin to address that by making it as clear as possible, you know, that it's okay to do this and it ought to be done, you know, and to congregation, you know, that your ministers, you know, need to have the space to do this, etc. So, I mean, it's just one example, but you know, I think planting that in the most formative stages of our equipping, you know, as leaders would be an essential ingredient, I would say. I don't know. Do you have any thoughts about it?
No, I'm just struck with, as I look at the group, I'm just struck with guys just understand how important that this really is as far as the one anothering. Because when you get out there in that ministry, it all of a sudden gets really lonely. And so make sure you have people you connect with that you can trust.
So yeah, I stand here and I listen to what you contributed today. And I am not pessimistic about the church.
Yes.
But, man, the enemy of your souls is after you like a roaring lion to devour you from the inside out. You know, this is a battle.
Yeah.
And it's not that we try to find a way out of the battle. It's always going to be a battle. The only question is, you know, are we equipped and empowered, you know, to face those things and be more than conquerors, you know, in him. So, you know, I'm not pessimistic. I'm optimistic. I'm excited when I hear and speak to you, you know, and you know, for me, my hope is that, you know, you will find these ways. Put them in place now. Don't wait till you're desperate for it.
Okay.
You know.
In your experience, what's been some of the best ways to help make people hungry?
Yeah. Well, I think the first thing that I would ask leaders, I mean, at one level, you can't make people hungry. Do you know what I mean? It is actually the work of the Holy Spirit to do that. But I would say, first place, as leaders, I would say, are you hungry? Okay. I think hunger is contagious. You know, you hang around hungry people and the hunger get, you know, you become hungry, excited for the things that people get excited for, you know, longing for the things that get longing for. So, you know, if you want hungry people, actually be hungry. So one of the dangers of church leadership, especially from the kind of institutional programmatic perspective, is we often want our people to be, you know, to be and to do and to have the kind of spiritual life that we don't take care of in ourselves, you know. And we think we can sort of generate, it doesn't matter how we are, we can generate it in other people, you know. But if what I've been saying, the logic of Jesus' example and of what I've been saying here is that actually our responsibility, you know, is to seek the life that we want other people to have. So, you know, that's the basic principle. Are we hungry? Then there's lots of ways. I think, you know, testimony makes people hungry, I think, you know. We don't have a culture of testimony in most of the churches that I know of, mainline churches. In our church now, the bulk, well, no, it could be that it's not actually, but the bulk of what could be some of our celebration services is basically open mic time. And the mic is open and one person after another will come and will speak about where they have seen God at work in their lives, things that they're thankful for, etc. You know, but naming the presence and the work of God in all of those things, you know. And you've got to cut it short because, you know, it's just, it goes on. It goes on. And it's great that it goes on. And the great thing about testimony, of course, is that when you hear hear testimony, not from the preacher, but from, you know, ordinary people, like the preacher, but you know what I mean, is that testimony is meant, that what the Spirit does is, when you hear testimony, is it says, when it comes from an ordinary person, it stirs up that thought, well, if God can do that for them, he can do that for me. And you begin, you know, I mean, how do we ever learn or desire the things that we do? It's usually because we've seen something in someone else that we, you know, that we think's awesome, you know, and we want to be like that, you know. we could talk about the principle of imitation, you know, in Paul and others, if we wanted. But I would say that it, you know, our church didn't start like that. There were some silences. But what we've done is we coupled that open mic there into our house fellowships, where the core practice of our house fellowships is practicing the presence of God. The core question is, where have we seen God at work? And people are just are learning, because it's a skill to open your eyes, you know, to see and learn how to see and learn how to not just see stuff happen, but see how God might be actually involved and at work in things. Name it, talk about it, and to learn that it's not the big testimony of this person getting converted or this healing or something, but it's in the small things of life, you know, in the nitty-gritty things, you know, just small things. And doing that, and then often, you know, those conversations are brought into the public, you know, celebration. So testimony is one thing, and sometimes I think hunger can be. I mean, I could go on, but another thing I would say is that, pray for the Holy Spirit. You know, lay hands on people. Pray that they receive the Holy Spirit. Take people out on mission. Get people out of their comfort zones, and they'll soon long for what they haven't got. The ability, the resource, whatever, you know. Helping people just be on that edge. Sometimes I think it's just a mixture of those things, but those things that immediately come to mind. I have a whole kind of session that I do on that, and I can't now, in my jet lag before late in the afternoon, hypoglycemic state, remember it all, but I can share some more. But those will be the things that immediately come to mind. That helps. Hmm.
Do you suppose that it's just in the nature of the way church is this insular concept that we have as individualistic concept where we are not necessarily using our spiritual gifts? Do you think that kind of plays into some of this lack of hunger?
Yeah. That's a good point. So, you know, I haven't mentioned. My mind's going in various places. I haven't mentioned, you know, the doctrine of Christian perfection, which you know, my summary would be: cast a vision for how awesome it is to become ever more like Jesus, not just in moral character, but in doing the things he did. How would you like that? How would you like to be like that? How would you like to be like Jesus like that, you know? I think that teaching, that one of the ways we can, I mean, another answer to the question is cast that vision for the promises that God's made. You know, you can be like this. I can work through. And then ask, now, do you really want this? Then let's pray for it. Let's seek it, you know? Same thing with the gifts. So I think, you know, but, I mean, Paul talks about eagerly desiring the gifts of the Spirit. There's a hunger language in there, you know. So, I mean, who here would like the gift of prophecy? Would you? Pray for it. Because actually, Paul says, eagerly desire the spiritual gifts, especially the gift of prophecy. We need people who don't just, you know, talk about God. We need people who actually can speak, you know, as Peter puts it, you know, speak the very words of God, you know. Or there's a power in our speaking to one another. I love it, actually, that that little one anotherings under worship. I'm never sure. This is a little bit of a construction, you see. So it says, it doesn't say, I always used to think it said, you know, sing psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs. It doesn't say that, actually. What it says is, address one another. Speak, actually, it's actually to one another. Speak psalms, hymns, you know. It's all about that kind of, I mean, they may be sung, of course, you know, but it, what it is, it's about the way that our speaking with one another, our sharing with life with one another, etc., carries that that power and those giftings. And do we want those things? I hope we do. So, you know, hungering for that. The thing that I keep praying for is that God will raise up evangelists. Now, I don't specifically mean more Billy Grahams. Actually, I don't mean Billy Grahams. What I mean is Ephesians 4:11, people who will actually equip the saints for ministry. Those who have such a heart for evangelism and actually do share the gospel in certain gifted ways, but who take that gift and enable people like me, you know, to get excited about sharing my faith with other people. Apostles, pastors, those with hospitality, radical hospitality. I think that's the thing, you know. You know, there's two kinds of there's hospitality. Have you ever, do you serve tea and coffee ever in your churches? Do the people that serve tea and coffee have the gift of hospitality? You know, what do you want, tea? You know, this is not the gift of hospitality, right? You know, this, you know, it might be help, you know, meeting a need or something. You know, the gift of hospitality is when that person who gives you that cup of tea or coffee, you know, looks into your eyes and you see the love of Jesus in there, you see the work of the Holy Spirit in there, and there might even be a moment where that person, you know, giving you a cup of tea says to you, are you okay? What's going on? You don't look the same as normal. How can I pray for you? I don't know if that answers your question at all, but it gets close. All big questions, aren't they? Any other
burning things? Kind of on that, how do you go about encouraging people to find their spiritual gifts and use them within the church context, especially people who might not even know what that means, and like training them in doing that?
Yeah. Well, I think, you know, one place to start is to do some teaching on it. Rarely, it's not often taught on, it seems to me. And not even, you know, in college, I don't know whether we kind of outsourced it to the Pentecostals, but you know what? They're really not very good at it either. I have these conversations, apart from, you know, certain markers like speaking in tongues or something, right? But beyond that, so good teaching about it and connecting and helping people see how what Paul talks about here is really, you know, is about the kinds of things that Jesus did, you know, to minister people, to create that understanding, etc. And then you know, there are various processes. I'm very happy to send you some stuff if you want to email me, but you know, there are various things that you can do to help people identify their gifts potentially, you know, because often, I mean, a spiritual gift is a kind of coming together of our natural abilities made supernatural, you know, by the power of the Spirit. It's a co-working, a working together with the Spirit, and so often, you know, it might be that you begin with the sorts of things that you enjoy doing or feel called. So, you know, people can already be exercising hospitality, let's say, but haven't seen that as an opportunity for it to become a spiritual gift, in the sense of learning how to intentionally be sensitive to the flow of the Holy Spirit in that, and what it means to let that then, you know, work itself out. So part of it is about, you know, looking at how we are made differently and what our different gifts are. But you, often one of the mistakes is that it then stops there. So what people say is, what are you good at? Okay, that's your gift, what the Spirit's given. Now, it may be that the Spirit's woven us together to be that kind of person with that kind of gift, but I think a spiritual gift, you know, the charismata, you know, the grace gifting, the graced gift, you know, is when the Spirit takes that up and uses it in that missional way. So it's, you know, about helping people to make that connection. So, you know, there are tools, there are like spiritual gift inventories. So sometimes it's just, you know, you can go, there are some tools where you can go through and just reflect on some questions and say, oh yeah, I like that, I'll do that. Maybe there's some seeds of a gift there that I've not seen. So you can go through a process like that. But I would say that by far the best way is for your gifts to be recognized by others. But then the question is, who knows you well enough? you know where I'm circling back around to here. So, you know, who knows you well enough to discern, you know, what's just you, you know, or what the spirit, how the spirit is working in you in certain ways, or both. And there's no substitute, I think, for building those spiritual friendships, being in those sorts of groups together, and seeking together. Because so often we can't see in ourselves, you know, what God is putting in us. It takes others to recognize that. And thank God, you know, all leadership ought to be detected that way. People that really want to be leaders are the people you ought to be most worried about. But I don't know, does that help? Yeah. I just wouldn't try to argue them into it. You know, pray them into it. Exercise your spiritual gifts before them. You know, lead by example. I don't know. It depends. I mean, are you talking about people who are kind of like secessionist in principle? You know, and they're kind of like that's where they're at, and it's reasoned. Or do you mean just people who have never thought about it before and are a bit suspicious about it and don't really like it and don't really want to go there?
No, like the secessionist. Like, I've come across people who think that speaking in tongues was something that specifically happened in the apostles because it needed
right.
to happen. And that people who claim that they can speak in tongues now
right.
are like having devil worship.
Yeah, yeah, I know. I don't think I've got a better answer. I don't think that, you know, with people that we radically disagree with, you know, at most foundational levels, I think that all we can do is seek to remain friends, to love, to respect, but to be who we are and pursue what we do, and, you know, demonstrate in our own lives and those who would be like-minded, the truth of it in practice. I mean, it's a slightly different case if those people are preventing others, for instance, from pursuing those gifts. Then you need to exercise some sensitive pastoral, you know, insight, you know, into the best way to encourage others to do that, you know, in that, or you know, to help that person who has that opinion to not impose that on other people. But I don't. Persuade by example, I think is the best answer I've got. Can anybody else help her? Yes, thank you. That's helpful. Yeah, yeah. And actually, that's a really helpful point. The fruit and the gifts need to go together. It's the one and the same spirit. There's one and the same spirit that gives the gifts. So whatever our spiritual gift is, it ought to be marked by love and peace and patience, you know, and joy. You know, yeah. Yeah. Any other questions? I don't know what time is.
Encourage them to be here, okay? Because I think it'll be a good one. But
Can I just, before you wrap up with this, just say, I've put here, we've produced lots of resources about this stuff on our website. It's all free to download. There are some paper versions. There are some versions that are laminated. Now, okay, these are for you to look at and not take away, okay? anything that's printed down here, feel free to take. And there are just some, but then there's a bit of a wider example of some of the things that you might be interested in on here. Again, if you could just look at these and not take them away. If you want any of this stuff, then either download it or be in contact with me. I'm very happy to make sure you get what you need. But for the sake of the next people that might look at this stuff, take this, accept the plastic. Look at this. Thank you.
Thank you very much.